Good morning, Kash. And so we'll be just going to be into the 14th lesson. So yesterday we have also been saw what are the different last of the previous two classes. We have been just getting to know how the Mughals they have been came from which place and how they have been ruled our country. And at the same time, who were the most important rulers? What are their policies? How they maintained the relations with the other empires? So, and at the same time, we also saw what is meant by Mansabdar, Chabidar, all this. So once I will just give a recapitulation of the what we have been discussed in the previous class. So the very first one, we have been saw about who were the Mughals, from which place they have been came. And at the same time, we also saw the timeline of the different kinds of Mughal emperors. This has been on your text page number 127. First was Babur, then second Humayun, Akbar, Jahangir, Shah Jahan, and the Aurangzeb. So next we have also saw the relations of the Mughals with other rulers. So basically we have been saw they have been occupying the complete Asia from the central parts they have been came and to the India, all the different directions they have been started occupying. And mostly in that one, they have had a very good relations with the Rajputs, and even the mothers of Jahangir and Shah Jahan, their mothers were belonged to the Rajput princes. So likewise, they maintained a very good relations with the other rulers. And not only that one, the one more, the very thinkable aspect, and not only the thinkable, they wanted to have the control over the places which they have been won. During the time of war, any kingdom has lost, so that kingdom will automatically come under the kingdom who has been won. So when this about this Mughal empires, what they did, whatever the kingdom they had been, they have been winning the victory over the kingdoms, they were asking that kingdom, that kings only to rule. But what they are making, they were giving that kingdom as an assignment. Assignment is not the homeworks or the work to do, you know. Assignment is one area or one particular place to rule as a head of that particular that process. And these persons, what they will be doing, they should not do as they want, like their rules, regulations, like policy. So whatever the Mughal kings they were saying, they need to follow that instructions and they need to obey by the people. So in this way they have been doing it. So having good, maintaining a good relations with the people. Next one.
Second class, eh?
Next one, about the Mansabdar and Jagirdars. So Mansabdar and Jagirdars, what was Mansabdar means? Mansabdar means the landholders. In the army they were allotting. Whereas coming to the Jagirdar means he will be collecting the revenue. Means like how in the 13th lesson and 12th lesson we have Nayankara system, only to collect the revenue from the traders, from the agricultural people, all this they will collect it. So Mansabdar, they are the landholders, like chiefs, army chiefs, chieftains, warriors, like this. So these Mansabdar, they were accompanying the kings everywhere. Like whenever they are going to war, they'll be accompanying. If they like every aspect of the duty they have been doing to the king, to suppress the rebellion, to control the any province. Province of the state. So likewise they were helping the king. And at the same time, this Mughal empire, the kings also they were giving some areas under these Mansabdars. So Mansabdars, what they need to do, you know, they need to take the control of that particular place or area which has been allotted by the king. And at the same time, he also need to maintain his personal army, like horses, elephants, cavalrymen, weapons, all this they need to maintain. And these Mansabdars, they were transferring from that place to the other place for every 2 years or 3 years. They were not allowing the Mansabdars to rule that place for forever, like permanent. They are not permanent, they will be shifting off from one place to the, transferring from one place to the other places. Likewise, same with Jagirs also, who will be collecting the revenue from the agricultural people, traders, cavalrymen, whoever they have been doing the work. And these Jagirs, who will be collecting the money, they are known as the Jagirdars. So these Jagirdars, they were also transferring from one place to the other place, because they doesn't these Mughal rulers, they doesn't want these Mansabdars and Jagirdars to stay permanent permanently. So they are temporary. If they are staying permanently, means they will become more powerful and they try to suppress the kings and they become the Okay, so we have been saw in this previous lessons of Kakatiyas, Nayankara system, all this, how they became powerful. So this, they doesn't want to continue with the this Mansab Khans and Jagunas. So this Mansab Khan, it is not a hereditary. Hereditary means not related from the generations to generation. So whenever any Mansab Khan has been expired, died, so it is about the king's duty that whether he wanted to give that Mansabdar, that area to his son or not. Or even sometimes the Mansabdar's area, whatever he has been running of his army, all this, whatever he had, he might be take away or he might not, the king might be or might not be going to take away all these things. So overall, these Mansabdars and Jagirdars, they are playing a very good role till the Akbar's and the next Jahangir, all they have been following the same, like how this has been started from Babur, Humayun, then Akbar, all they have been following. But at the time of Aurangzeb, when he came to the power, these Jahangirs, they have been, what do you, they allotted some percentages, like from agriculture, 10% of money, the tax need to be get collected, from traders, 15%, so like that. But when Aurangzeb came to power, these Jahangirs, they were started collecting more and more from the farmers, from the traders, and they were becoming more powerful. And how powerful they became is with the Mansabdar and Jagirdars, they were compared. So Mansabdars became very less and Jagirdars were becoming more and more in numbers during the time of the Aurangzeb. So definitely this was the end of the, this is also one of the cause for the Aurangzeb's end of the Delhi. But whereas compared to the Akbar, he has also been, he divided the collecting of the tax, how much tax means the jagir, how much the revenue need to pay them. So in this way, Babur, Humayun, Jahangir, Akbar, all this they followed the same. But Aurangzeb's tenure of time, the farmers they suffered, all the traders, so they rebelled against this Jagirdars, and due to that one, Aurangzeb's tenure also came to an end. This is also one of the cause for the Aurangzeb's tenure loss. Now next thing we will is going to deal with the Zabta and Zamindar. When explaining the synopsis, I have been said about the Zabta and Zamindar. Zabta, you know, it is about the revenue system. And this Zamindar is an intermediary.
In some areas, the zamindar exercised
of power. The exploitation by the Mughal administrator could drive them to rebellion. Sometimes, zamindars and peasants lied in rebellion against the Mughal authority. These zamindar and peasants' revolt challenged the stability of the Mughal Empire from the end of the 17th century. So this Zabt system is revenue system. Who started out this first one is? It has been started by Todamal. Todamal, who was famous, he was a revenue minister. He was a revenue minister to Emperor Akbar. Revenue minister in Akbar kingdom. For Akbar, he has been the revenue minister. And he observed the carefully the revenue system for 10 years. 1570 to 1518, he observed the area. How much in a specified area, what type of crop they will be growing, how much they have been growing. So according to that one, by studying, by seeing the survey, by doing the calculation works, all this, then they lay the prices and percentage. So suppose this area is very good growing of the rice. So for this rice, this much area, how much percentages they charge. This area wheat and another area other type of crops. So likewise they have been divided, made the calculations and they have been decided the prices and how much the traders, the farmers they need to pay. And this is not possible in Gujarat and the Bengal place because it's been completely vast and this can be possible in the small areas. So this is Bengal and Gujarat, it is going to be done by the Mughal administrator. Administrators mean who will be given the assignments, these Mansabdar and holders, they were going to hand it out. Now next, this is about the Zamindars. Now what is Zamindars means they were not appointed by the Mughals. They are hierarchy, hereditary form. They were intermediaries or middlemen between the Mughal Empire rulers and between the local people of that area. So whatever the problem that they are facing by the local people, they will be going to inform the king or to the Mansabdar or to the Jagirdar. And in that way, they will be having a middleman between that area of local people and this one. And these Zamindars are so powerful that there is a hierarchy. They are permanent. They are not temporary. They cannot change up. So as because of the hierarchy, they know that area very well. How much they have been very good, how much they have been collecting. So in this way, some amount they will be getting from the farmers and from the other persons. And not only that, these Zamindars, like Jagirdars, like these Mansabdars, how they have been maintaining their military, their power. Likewise, also these Zamindars, they were also having the army, small army like horses and very few in number. But they are very powerful. If they are, this is also one of the cause of these Zamindaris and peasants. So with the collaboration, Zamindar plus peasants, farmers. These two, they have been collaborated when the end of the 17th century, when Aurangzeb, these Jagirdars were collecting of more revenue. So these Zamindar, already the Zamindar, he was having the army. So, and help of the people. So these two, they have been joined. They are rebelled against the Mughal Empire. And this also one of the cause for the end of the Mughal. The first was about these Jagirdars. Then second is about these Zamindars and peasants. They have been rebelled against the kings. Because they are very powerful and when they have been rebelled, these Zamindars, they were appointed as a village head. And they started ruling that particular area. So in this way, Zabt and Zamindar system, later on the Zamindars became very powerful and they became the stability of the Mughal Empire was in completely declined. And after that one, these Zamindars, they will become the head of that particular places to which areas they were the head process. Now next thing is about the Akbar's policies. So what are the Akbar, how he did, what are the what are the different kinds of policies he has been done in his court, who were the persons. And in this most important, I'll just go with this page number 131, this yellow color inbox, the universal peace of people, and this is very important one. What according to Jahangir, his son, he describes it. So Jahangir Akbar's son describes his father's policy of Sultan. It is also known as universal peace. As a wide expansion of the divine compassion, there is a room for all classes and followers of all creed. So in his imperial dominions, which all sides were limited only by the sea, there was room for professions of opposite religions and for beliefs, good and bad, the road to the intolerance was closed. Sunnis and Shias meet in the mosque and Christians and Jews in one church to pray. He consistently followed the principle of universal peace, Sultan. And here figure 14.4, Akbar holding discussions with learned individuals of different faiths in his Ibadat Khana. So this like industry. example they have been given on. And Ibadat Khana is a religious room or a place where he will be discussing with the different kinds of religious scholars of different religion. But as you know, Sulke Kul, one of the links of by his son Jagir, what he is saying, all the religious people, they will be sitting together at one place, they were discussing. And all the same, in religion also there were different caste, different creeds. Like in Islam, we are most preferred Sunni and Shia. Then next in Hinduism also different Shaivas, Vaishnavism, all these they were existing. And in Christianity also, Roman Catholics and other people, Roman Catholics, non-Roman Catholics, then Jews, all these people, they need to worship in one place, one church, one temple. So in this way, the peace will be existing. And if it is, the peace has been existing, there will be no intolerance towards the other caste people. Intolerance is criticizing that religion, caste people, you belong to this caste, east crack, all this one. So if it is no, the roots of the intolerance will be get closed. So roots of the intolerance will be get closed means all will be living happily, in harmony, in peace, no discrimination, no any kind of quarrel or fighting. So in this way, if one group of people, they will be living in the peace, so definitely the complete society is also going to be in the peace. As further and further it increases, and ultimately the universe, it will be in the peace. So that is what the Sulke Kul, universal peace. So now the closer look of the Akbar's policy, what he has been did up. So the broad feature of administration was laid by Akbar, was very elaborately discussed by his friend and member of his court, Abul Fazl, in his book Akbarnama. So in his court, there is his friend, at the same time is an administrator who will be giving the his ideas, views, how to do it, or the plan, need to lay out the plan. So Abul Fazl, A-B-U-L-F-A-Z-L. So he wrote a book called Akbarnama. So in his Akbarnama, all the Akbar's administrative work, how he did, what are the policies, all everything is being written in this book. So while Akbar was at Fatehpur Sikri near Agra during 1570s, he initiated means he took a first step. Important discussions on religions with the Muslim scholars, Brahmins, Jesus priests, whomever of Roman Catholics, Zoroastrian, means they belong to this Parsi religion. He was interested in the religion and social customs of different people. Akbar wanted to bring together the people of diverse faith. This eventually gave Akbar the idea of Sulke Kul or universal peace. This idea of tolerance did not discriminate among people of different religions in his kingdom. Instead, it focused on a system of ethics, honesty, justice, peace. This was universally applicable. Abul Fazl helped Akbar in framing the vision of governance around his idea of Sulke Kul. The emperor would work for the welfare of all the subjects irrespective of their religion or social status. This principle of governance was followed by Jahangir and Shah Jahan as well. Aurangzeb deviated from this policy and tried to protect himself as favoring only Sunni Muslims. People of other religions felt admonished by this policy of Aurangzeb. So this Akbar policy, it is universal peace, Akbar policy. In this Akbar policy, what the main important universal peace he wanted to attain? The universal peace with all the religions. So to attain this universal peace, the three ethics, what he maintained the three ethics, the very first he said about honesty, then next is he said about the justice, then other is about the peace. These three are being applicable to all the religion, all the religion people, irrespective of anyone. So if the person is being honest, if he do not do any kind of cheating or any kind of corruption or any, yes, if it is, it is the values, if he is being honest, then to give the justice, he will get to know which is good and which is bad, how to, who is right, who is wrong. So justice should be get rid of. And justice being prevailed in a fair manner, not maintaining any kind of social status, powerful or less powerful. So if justice is being given in a fair manner, then ultimately the peace will be going to get exist in the not only his kingdom, throughout the different kingdoms whoever being followed. So these are the three main important contents of this universal peace. So this Akbar, he wanted all the religious people of different castes, he wanted to have look on culture, tradition, he wanted to have the universal peace need to be get exist in the society. So in this way, after Akbar, his son Shah Jahan, along with this one Jahangir, both they have been followed the same, like how Akbar has been followed. But again here Aurangzeb, he deviated from this universal peace policy. What he did? As I mentioned in Islam, there are two set of most important people. One is of Sunni and other is of Shia. So, as he belongs to the Sunni set of people, he gave importance to the Sunni, that society, that caste people, the society people. He doesn't give any importance to the other. So, this also one of the cause of Aurangzeb's tenure to be set back, and one of the cause for the end